Do we have a problem with pride? This week we looked at a message about the destruction of disobedience, and in the very beginning of the message, Brother Mike began to talk about pride and Herod's issue with pride, and he said a statement in there that really got my mind going and really engaged me. He said this: pride leads to arrogance, which leads to prayerlessness. And he talked about how pride is the background that all sinful acts are shown. It's this sin that's kind of in the background. It has its entrails into every sin that we have in our lives. You can trace it all the way back to pride. And so it's a really, really major issue. And so we need to ask the question, are we aware of the pride in our lives? And as he talked about that statement, pride leads to arrogance, which leads to prayerlessness, I began to think about how much I pray, and I felt really convicted about the lack of prayer that I have in my life, which then made me realize that I am a whole lot more prideful than I probably think I am. And so the first thing that I kind of want to talk to you about is like prayer is a gauge for pride. It kind of shows us how much pride we have. The less we pray, listen, the reality is the more prideful we are, whether we want to admit that or not. And in fact, if we don't admit it, that's prideful in itself. But the second thing is that I began to think about and really began to churn it on is prayer regulates pride. So not only does it show us where we are on, say, the pride scale, but it also, prayer can help us bring down and regulate the pride in our lives. And the reason for this is because prayer is an action of humility. I mean, to come to the Lord in prayer, to call upon the name of the Lord is to say, I need you. So just the act of opening your mouth and communicating with God is communicating your need for God, which begins to lower how you view yourself or your understanding of yourself, which is pride. When we're humbling and when we're adoring God, it actually regulates and brings down our pride. And so I wanted to read you a verse, and we know in Acts chapter 9, this is where Paul is on the way to Damascus, blinding light, and then God shows up to a guy named Ananias and says, hey, Paul's going to be here, you need to go talk to him. And his response is very good. He says, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm has been done to your saints in Jerusalem. But check this out, the next line. And here in Damascus, he, this Paul fellow, also has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call upon your name. Do you see what Ananias just did? He referred to those who are believers, what we would call Christians today. He actually identified them as people of prayer or people who call on the name of the Lord. Could that be said of us? If we talk to the people around us, would they say, you know, Austin, yeah, that's that guy. He's, man, that guy prays. Would the people that are closest to me even identify me as that? But not only there, it also happens again, just a couple of verses down, Ananias meets with Paul, and then Paul gets saved and immediately begins to preach the gospel. And it says he, in verse 20, he immediately preached to Christ in the synagogues that he is the Son of God. Then all who heard were amazed and said, is this not he who destroyed those who called on this name in Jerusalem, or called on the name of the Lord in Jerusalem? Again, we see the people in Jerusalem referred to by the people in Damascus, those who are following Jesus, as people who call upon the name of the Lord. They were called and identified as people of prayer. Now, it's no wonder that the church in Acts, the first church, is one of the most humble and hardworking and prideless church that we see. They were not people of pride because they were people of prayer and they were identified that. So what's two things that we can do? Very simply, this is not lofty. The first thing that we can do is pray alone in the morning. This has been a very good practice for me. I just try to get up earlier than everybody else, and I just try to get alone with God and prayer. And it's a time where God humbles me, and I begin to adore Him and pray to Him and those things, and it regulates pride in my life. Prayer is about a personal thing between you and God, but as we look in Scripture, it's also a corporate thing, and it was a corporate thing with the people of Israel in this time, in the first century, in the first church. And so we should not only just pray alone, but we should pray with our families at the very least, and with our church. But so pray at night with your family. This is a practice that Elizabeth and I have been doing with Eleanor, and she can't really understand what we're saying, and she jabbers the whole time, and it's not a pretty thing. It's not elegant, and it may not be elegant with your family. Your kids may be throwing balls at each other and everything else, but the point is that they're going to see you praying, and that they are going to understand that you are calling on the name of the Lord, and that you are not a prideful person, but you're a person of humility that stands before God in need. If you want to check out our last video, click here. If you want to follow us on social media, go to any of our platforms. It's SBC Clinton, at SBC Clinton, and subscribe to our YouTube channel so you can see more content like this one.